Well, I can tell I'm in a United Methodist Church. Because evidently you guys didn't get the memo when the song said that Satan is vanquished. Do you get the picture here? Satan doesn't win. He loses. You should be excited about that. You should be happy about that. That whatever you face in this world doesn't win. It doesn't get the last say. One of these days, you will get excited about that. I promise. Before I leave this church, I will not leave this church until you guys get excited about that at some point. Hopefully, it will happen. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to Acts chapter 8. We'll be turning there in just a few moments. So we're in the fourth week of the series, Resolutions, which I've been challenging you to make some decisions with me that will have a significant impact on your faith and your relationship with Jesus. We've talked about a resolution, what a resolution is, and it's a firm decision to do or not do something. Two things that we find in a resolution is that there's firmness and there's determination to make it happen. Well, I'll be honest with you, when I went to the gym this week, it's getting kind of thin in there. It's starting to wane a little bit. It was getting pretty full, but it's starting to go back to normal again. Because people have already given up. But the thing is, our faith is so much more important. Our relationship with Jesus is so much more important than losing weight. It's so much more important than getting our finances right. Those are good things that should happen, but they're not the priority, or they shouldn't be the priority in our lives. It should be our faith. So the second week, I challenged you with the first resolution. So resolution number one was chair time. To spend 15 minutes a day. A day, that means 15 minutes out of a 24-hour period to sit alone with God. To be fully engrossed in only God. To shut out everything else around you and to focus in on what God wants to speak into your life, whether that's reading the scriptures or going through a devotional, or it's just sitting there and listening to God. Well, I'll be honest with you. I've got ADD. 15 minutes is like an hour when you're sitting and trying to listen. It's difficult. I literally had to start setting a timer on my phone so I knew that I was not getting up until it went off. If I go longer, that's great, but I know I'm not getting up until it goes off. Simple thing that you can do. It's not a bad thing. It's something that helps us focus. So I encourage you, again, 15 minutes. If you want to hear that whole message, all the messages are on our website, so I encourage you to go there if you haven't heard them. So last week I challenged you with resolution number two to discover your spiritual gifts and begin to develop them and put them into practice. I gave everyone a spiritual gifts assessment, sent it home with you. I have a couple people that have given them to me. If you don't have one, if you lost it from here to your house, or if you lost it in your house, it's okay. I've got copies for you when you leave. There are extras. Feel free to take as many as it takes. That's all I have to say. So last week I talked briefly about how we need each other. That we were created to literally rely and need other people in our lives. So let me ask you with this question. Let me start with this question for you. How many of you got where you are today? And I mean in life. I don't mean how did you get here today. So how many of you got where you are today on your own power, your own wisdom and abilities? How many of us, show of hands, would say, I got here on my own, where I am today? Good. Good. And for those of you who didn't want to raise your hand, I'm pretty sure the Ten Commandments said something about not lying. How many of you are here today because of people who invested in your life, whether it be through education or teaching you some life experiences that they had themselves, or maybe it was a coach who made an extra effort to invest in you beyond just the sporting ability, but to invest in you as a person? How many people would say that? And hopefully everyone else would still have their hands up because of, hopefully, your parents invested in you. I know that's not always something that happens, but hopefully we all got here because of somebody else and their investment in us. So this week, my resolution that I'm challenging you to make is to invest and invite. To invest and invite. You know, one of the things that I realized I kind of like to do is, I'm not extremely good at it because I'm learning as I go, is I like getting my hands dirty and working on my cars. I don't like it when they break down, but I like working on my vehicles. Kind of get that probably from my dad. But you know, there are some times where I look in my toolbox for a tool that I need, and the tool's there. I've got what I need to do the job that I need to do. But there are other times where I'm digging through my toolbox and I realize I don't have what I need, and so I make a phone call. My first phone call is to my dad. Hey, Dad, do you have this tool in your toolbox? And a lot of times, most of the time, he says, yep, I've got one, and he brings it to me. But there are other times where I call him and he says, well, do you have one of these? And it's a tool I actually have. It's not the special tool that I would do it in like 2 seconds type of thing, but it's another tool that I have. And he says, well, why don't you take that tool and use it this way? Okay. So what does that mean? Why do I say that? Well, you see, sometimes in the situations that I face in my life and the decisions that I have to make and the choices that I'm faced with, I've got my life experiences and I can go to my toolbox of life and I can pull out what I need to apply to this situation, and I know what I already need to do to make the best decision. But sometimes I don't. I don't have the life experience. I don't have the knowledge or wisdom to know how to best, in an educated way, make the best decision. And so I call up someone because I need them. I need their life's wisdom. I need them to speak into my life, to help me, to inform me, to make the best decision that I can. But you know, other times, I make that phone call, and I realize that they're saying to me on the other end, you have the tools. You just haven't learned how to use it yet. And so the person on the other end of the phone is telling me, hey, why don't you do this and try it this way? You've got all the tools you need. You just need to learn how to use the tool. You see, that's how we are in life. Sometimes we'll have the answers. Sometimes we need other people to help us. And other times we have what we need, we just don't realize it. So we need other people to speak into our lives to help us and to educate us on how to grow as people. So if you will, turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 8, and we'll look at a passage of Scripture where this becomes a reality. Starting in verse 26, it says, now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road
the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. Okay, let's stop right there for a second. How do you think that Philip was able to hear from the angel? How do you think that he was able to hear from the angel? Because he listened? Here's what I think. I think Philip spent time in his chair. I think Philip postured himself in a way to be able to hear from God. So why do I say sit in the chair for 15 minutes alone? Because if you haven't already learned this, God does not scream at us the answer. God does not scream when he communicates to us. He doesn't even necessarily talk in a normal voice. He whispers. Because what do we have to do if he whispers? We have to put all of our attention on listening. And we have to focus on what he's saying. And so for order for Philip to be in a place where he can hear from God and the angels that God has sent, he has to posture himself in a way to be able to hear from the presence of God. Verse 27, so he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of the treasury of the Candake, which means queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone down to Jerusalem to worship. Young boys, if you close your ears for just a second, we need to have a little conversation about what this eunuch is. If you don't already know what a eunuch is a man who has been castrated. This was a practice that they used quite often in that time for servants who were either male servants to the king's harem, or you were a servant under a queen and you were male, because the king was not taking any chances. So he just took out any opportunity you had, okay? So this man was an Ethiopian eunuch who was over the treasury, so he was in charge of the finances of the queen of Ethiopia. Make a little sense, okay? So he had gone to Jerusalem to worship. Well, because he was a eunuch, there was no way that he could ever become fully a Jew and those times. So when he went to worship, he would have gone to what is called the court of Gentiles, which is like as far outside the temple as you could possibly get, but yet still be in the temple court. And only the Jews and the religious elite could go beyond the court of the Gentiles. So you and I, if we were in that time, we would not be permitted to go beyond the court of Gentiles. And so his worship was limited when he went to the temple. But we see really quickly his devotion to his faith, starting at verse 28, it says, and on his way home, he was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, go to the chariot and stay near it. So not only does Philip hear from God, he's postured himself in a way to hear from God, but now we see that Philip obeys. He's obedient to what God is telling him to do. And so he goes to the chariot and he goes up to the Ethiopian. It says, then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you're reading? Philip asked. How can I? He said. Unless someone explains it to me. What is the Ethiopian saying? He needs to phone a friend. I don't know. I don't know what this is telling me. I don't know. I can't understand it. I need someone else to help me understand it. I need someone to take time and invest in me. Verse 32, it says, this passage of scripture that eunuch was reading, it says, he was led like a sheep to the slaughter, as a lamb before its shears is silent. So he did not open his mouth. In his humility, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with this, that very passage of scripture, and told him the good news about Jesus. And told him the good news about Jesus. So not only does he hear from God, but he is obedient and he hears. Jesus had something to say about this in a parable in Matthew chapter 25. Let me read it for you. It says, for I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers or sisters of mine, you did for me. You see, our obedience is not simply about us. Our obedience has a direct impact on the people around us. It has a direct impact on the people around us. God wants to use our lives to influence the people around us. So why did God send Philip to engage with this Ethiopian man? Why did God send him? It's a great question. I'm glad you asked. You see, Philip had what we call the spiritual gift of evangelism. He's actually known as Philip the Evangelist. You see, he had the gift of being able to communicate to people the good news of Jesus. He saw the need in this person's life, and he was able to take that simple scripture and tell him about the lamb that was slaughtered. Something Isaiah communicated some 500 years before it became a reality. And so not only is he able to take this scripture and teach this man about Jesus, he's able to show him how God was working in the world and in people's lives 500 years before, and even way before that, as we read in the Old Testament. That God had a plan. You see, Philip had postured himself to where he needed to be. He had spent time with God. He knew and recognized the angel's voice because it was from God. What's it say in Luke chapter 2? When the angel appears before the shepherds who are leading the flocks at night, and they came to pronounce the birth of Jesus. What does it say? It says that they were terrified. But here it says that Philip responded like it was nothing. See, he didn't have to be terrified because he knew who was speaking to him. He had heard God speak to him. And his only response was to respond in obedience, to use the gifts that God had given him. Could have been easy for Philip to say, you know what, he's not part of my group, so I'm just going to let him stay over there and I'll go tell my people about the gospel of Jesus Christ. But no, Philip goes and he speaks to this man. And he tells him about Jesus. He invests in him. He invests in his life. But then he doesn't stop there. He doesn't stop. Verse 36, it says, as they were traveling along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, here's water. What can stand in the way of being baptized, of me being baptized? What can stand in the way? And you see, as a Jew, Philip could have easily said, well, this, you haven't kept that law, and you're castrated, so sorry, you're out. And you don't follow these rules, and you're part of this group of people. And he could have easily done that, right? I mean, come on, we do it today. We do it today, don't we? I'm sorry, you did not give me the correct answer when I asked you what baptism was, so therefore you cannot be baptized. Sorry. If you don't give us the right answers, you're not in, you're out. And no, it's not how it works. It's not how it works. There was an invitation that was made. There was an investment that was made. And when there's an invitation, a lot of times someone receives. Sometimes it's the person doing the inviting. Sometimes it's the person who is invited. So my challenge to you is to do what Jesus did. We don't have to go out and get the bracelets to make ourselves all cool and remind ourselves, you know, WWJD. We don't have to do that. Great marketing idea, but you know, you don't have to go do those things. A simple thing. Jesus says to his disciples, as he calls them, he goes up to them and he says, come, follow me. Right there, there's an invitation and an investment. An invitation and an investment. But he doesn't stop there. What does he say? He says, and I will make you fishers of men. And I will make you fishers of men. What does that mean? You see, when we become followers of Christ, we're in the same situation as the first disciples were. They didn't have a discipleship strategy. They didn't know the Romans road, the whole description of, you know, if you don't know that, you look it up. They didn't have all the answers to what they were supposed to do to explain to all of the questions that someone's going to have when they ask about, you know, following Jesus. They didn't have all of those things. They didn't have a clue what spiritual gifts were. Philip didn't know that he had the gift of evangelism. He just knew that I've seen what Jesus did in these people's lives, and I can go tell them about that experience. Well, here's the thing. If you have ever experienced receiving Jesus Christ into your life, and you can see the old self that you were before having Jesus in your life, and you can see your new self of having Jesus into your life, guess what? You've got a story to tell of what Jesus did in your life. And by communicating what Jesus did in your life, you're communicating the good news. Guess what? That was all in your toolbox. Just sitting there waiting to be used. It's all there. There's no magic formula. Investing in a person simply means I'm willing to take time in my life and put it into yours. I'm willing to think about you when I do things. So let me give you some practical ideas. Let me break it down really small for you. What does investing in a person look like? Someone who may have some similar hobbies that you do. A program that that I really like that Grace does is the Christian outdoor ministry. An experienced older hunter will take in a guy or a girl under their wing, a young person, and he will go out and they will teach them how to hunt, but they don't just talk about how to shoot a gun straight. They talk about life issues. This person literally is taking their time to invest in them through teaching them a trade, through teaching them a hobby, something that they have similar interests, and they're talking about life, and now they're experiencing life together. A simple thing. Something that a hunter is already going to do, why do it alone? Take someone with you. Take a person out to lunch. Simply just go. You're going to go by yourself, right? You're going to go. Why not take someone with you? And just talk to them. Let me get this really straight. I'm not saying you need to take them to lunch, and the moment you sit down, you need to ask them, so where are you at with Jesus? If you want them to get up and walk away, by all means. But that's not the agenda, so don't do it. If you know already that they're pushing back and that their life does not reflect following Jesus, don't go there first. Build a relationship with them. They need to know you're there for them, not an agenda to get them into church. And see, that's the thing I want you to understand too, is I'm not saying to go invest in people because I want more people in the church. You know, see, that's the end. We're not doing this as a means to an end. What we're doing this as is to invest in people, to show people that we care about them. Eventually, those other things will happen in their own time. You and I don't know the timeline. You and I don't know when they're going to come to faith. We don't know when they're going to say, sure, I'll come to church with you. But here's the one thing I do know. If you never invite, you will never know what they'll say. And if you invite them and they say no, it's okay. But don't invite them once, them say no, and then you never ask them again. And they never see you again in their life. You go out to lunch, you're sitting there having a good meal, the conversation's going well, and you just say, hey, you know, would you like to come to church with me sometime? And they say, no, that's not my thing. And then they never hear from you ever again. That's just as bad as sitting down and saying, hey, how's your Jesus relationship? You know, they need to know you're investing in them, not in an agenda. So my challenge to you is to invest in people, in the person. So what does inviting them look like? Inviting them means asking them to join you in a family cookout. A simple thing. You're having a cookout with your family? Invite them. You and your spouse are having a night out together? And invite the couple to come with you. Invest in them together. Ask them if they want to join you in a Bible study. It's okay. Ask them if they want to come to a big game party with you. A simple thing. And here's the thing. Other than praying for the food, we probably won't be talking about Jesus all that much. Unless you're praying for your team to win. But I can promise you when they're there, they're one, they're going to have fun. Two, they're going to be supported. They're going to feel like they're welcomed. And the thing is, they're in a church basement, but they don't realize they're in a church building. Because they're not in here. So simple thing. At some point along the way, when you feel like it's an okay, approachable thing, invite them to come to church with you. Say, hey, you know what? You don't even have to waste your gas money. I will come pick you up. Statistically, they say it takes about an average of a person to be asked 7 times before they'll accept an invitation. And here's the thing. We don't know what number they're on until we ask. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to find one person. One person. Not a list of 30. One person. And probably right now you've already had someone come to your mind that you've thought about. If I were you, I would say that would be the person you would go with. One person to invest in. One person that you will invest time in. I'm not saying you have to spend every waking moment with this person. One person to invest in. And invite. Invite them to join you in your life experiences. Invite them to join you here. Invite them to join you with Jesus. Invite them. A simple thing. But here's where it gets hard. You see, some of us need to invest in our spouse. Some of us, that person that we invest in is our spouse. Some of us, it may be our children, even if they're bigger than us now. Some of us, it may be our mom or dad. We need to invest in them and let them know that they're loved and that you care about their life. And here's the thing, if we take this whole process seriously, because it all goes together, none of these are independent of each other. Spending time alone with God, developing the gifts that God has given you, investing in another person, if you haven't caught on, they go together. But here's the thing, if those things happen, our doors can't handle the people that will come through. Not just this one, but the churches all over. So what I want you to do is think about this. Think about if every single person in this room did this for this year, invested in one person, and it resulted in inviting that one person to join you here. Look around the room. What does that do? How does that impact the kingdom of God? You see, the thing that I love about God is he doesn't mess around with addition. He's all about multiplication. Because addition says, pastor, get to work. Multiplication says, body of Christ, get to work. But here's what I don't want you to ever forget. The first investment that you ever had was Jesus' investment in you. He invested in each one of us. But then he even invited us. An open invitation. Whenever you want to come, come. I'll be here. Whenever you're ready. He didn't force himself on us. He didn't push himself into our lives. He just said, I'm here, and I'll be here whenever you're ready. And one of the symbolic ways he does that is tells us to remember and celebrate that last meal that he shared with his disciples. Because you see, the thing about the table of Jesus is that the Jews and the Gentiles are all invited. The eunuchs, they're invited. The prostitutes, the people in the jails that are criminals, They're invited. Does that mean he condones everyone's behavior? No. But he loves them in spite of it. I want you to ask yourself, do you want to be loved that way? Do you want people to love you that way? What stops us from loving people that way? Because you don't have an excuse. You can't say, no one's ever loved me before. If you say that, you need to take a hard look at what Jesus has done for you. And that's what we remember. That's what we celebrate when we come to this table. We remember his sacrifice for our sins, the punishment he paid to forgive us of those sins. Pray that you invest and invite. Ushers, if you would come, service, please.